Okay, so the students who had joined late, kindly open the exercise 7.2 and I am going to explain the question number 3. So it is the question number 3 of exercise 7.2, and I am going to write the page number also. It is the revision section, so here it is the page number 116. It is given that suppose that if a number is given 1331. And if it is asked that find the cube root of this number, so one way is that you will go for the prime factorization method that will be applied, but here you need to find the cube root of this by without using the prime factorization. So whatever the number is given there, you need to make the tripling from the right side. From the right side you will make the numbers in the triple. So here I had taken, that is the one of the tripling of the number, three numbers you will take in a pair. So here it is three numbers. Now it is the remaining, so one number is remaining. So I got that 331. Now students, I had given one table where I had written that if the unit digit of the number is, suppose that one, so what will be the unit digit of the cube root of that number if it is 331? So here unit digit is one, so what will be the unit digit of its cube root? Any of the student? One. One table I had given, so kindly find that table where I had given that if the unit digit of the number is, suppose that one, so its cube root unit digit will be also one. So here first I will write from these three numbers, last three numbers, first I will write the unit digit of the number. So if you are going to find the cube root of this number, so its unit digit will be one. So I got the unit digit of the cube root of that number. Now whatever the number is remaining after that tripling, one is remaining, so here it is one. So find the number whose cube is either one or less than one. So one cube equal to one and two cube equal to eight. So eight is greater than this one. So one cube, it is equal to one. So whatever the number whose cube is either equal to one or just less than one, that number you will write. So here what the number you will write it? Here it is one. So it means that cube root of, here you will write cube root of 1331 equal to 11. So I will explain some more example related to that. Again, I am going to take another number. Okay, so here again I am going to take the another number which is given here, 4913. 4913. So again, what you will do? First, you will take the tripling from the right side. So I had taken the tripling. Whatever the number is remaining, that is 4. So you need to find the number which is after tripling. So tripling is 913. After that, you are going to get 4. What is the unit digit of this number? That is 3. So what will be the unit digit of its cube root? Any of the student? If the unit digit of the that will be 7. So if the number having the unit digit 3, then the unit digit of the cube root will be 7. So here you will write the unit digit of the cube root from this number, that is 7. Now leave this number 913, whatever the triple you had made, you need to leave that. And what is the number remaining? That is 4. 4 is remaining. Now 1 cube equal to 1, 2 cube equal to 8. So 2 cube is greater than 4. 2 cube is greater than 4. So what the number you will take? That is 1. So here you will put the 1. So it means cube root of 4913 is 17. So yes, Prachi, got it how to find that cube root without the prime factorization? Okay, Prachi, once again you need to answer. Yes. Now this method will be only wrong when the number is not a perfect cube. Here whatever the numbers are given, that are the perfect cube. That's why it will be correct. But if it is not a perfect cube, suppose that if 4913, here it is given a perfect cube. Suppose that if I am going to write the same number 3913, it is not a perfect cube. But suppose that if you are going to follow the same method, if I am going to ask that find the cube root of this, again you will follow the same method 913. So here 3 is there, so its unit digit will be 7, and here it is 3, So 1 cube equal to 1, 2 cube equal to 8. So 2 cube is greater than that 3. So here you will write 1. So you are going to say that here cube root of 3913 is also 17, and here cube root of 4913 is also 17. So that's why I am going to say, if the number is perfect cube, then that method will be correct. If the number is not a perfect cube, so that will be wrong. So got it? Yes. Any students who is having the doubt regarding this? Okay. I'm going to again explain a part. Okay, kindly mute your cell phone. Now Prachi Maurya, you need to unmute, and here I'm going to write a number, Prachi. Now if I'm going to write a number 32768, you need to explain my step by step. What you will do first? First you will make the tripling from the right side of the number. So here 768, that is the triple of the number, and 32 is the remaining. After tripling, whatever the number is remaining, that is 32. Now next step. What is the unit digit of the cube root of a number whose unit digit is 8? That will be 2. Yes, very good. So unit digit of the cube root of the number, that will be decided by the here, if it is 8, so its cube root unit digit will be 2. Now whatever the number is there, that is remaining after tripling, that is 32. Now what you will do, suppose that 1 cube is 1, 2 cube is 8, 3 cube is 27, 4 cube is 64. So you need to find the numbers whose cube is either equal to 38 or just less than 32. So 1 cube is 1, that is less than 32. 2 cube is 8, that is less than 32. 3 cube is 27, that is less than 32. But 4 cube is 64. This 64 is greater than 32. So what is the number just before coming before the 64? That is this one. 64 is greater than 32. So here it is this. So what the number you will kept here? Here it is 2. So what the number will be kept here? 3. Okay, so So whatever the number whose cube is greater less than 32 or equal to 32, that is 3. So that 3 you will keep it here. So you can write it cube root of 32768 equal to 32. So again, the students who are having the, okay, now you all of you need to mute. Now again, I am going to explain. Suppose that if any number is given, one number again I am going to take and I will explain that. Okay, so that the students who are having the doubt, their doubt will be clear. Suppose that if I am going to write a number 17,576, it is a perfect cube. And if it is asked that what is the cube root of this number? So first what you will do, you will make the tripling, and after tripling, whatever the number is remaining, that is 17. First you will write the here unit digit is 6. So what is the unit digit of the cube root of this number? No, that is not the 4. Any other student? That will be 6. If the unit digit of the number is 6, then its cube root unit digit will be 6. So first I will write the unit digit of the cube root of the number by that number. Here I had written it is 6. Now leave that tripling. Now what is the number remaining? That is 17. Now again, 1 cube is 1, 2 cube is 8, 3 cube is 27. Now 3 cube is greater than 17. So what the number you will take just before 27? It is 8, and 8 is the cube of 2. So what the number you will keep it here? That is 2. So here cube root of this number is 26. So again, if any students having the doubt regarding this, then ask me. Again, I will take one more example to explain that. Any other having the doubt? Yes, once more. Okay. Cube root. cube of 6, if you are going to find, if suppose that if you are going to add the cube of 6, so cube of 6 will be 6 cube, that is equal to 6 into 6 into 6, that will be the cube of the 6. Cube means you need to multiply the same number 3 times, and if it is cube root is given, that is the just reverse of that method. So cube of 6 will be 6 cube, that is 6 into 6 into 6. Okay. So now if again anyone having the doubt regarding this, so again I want to repeat that this method only you will apply where the number is the perfect cube. So in the question it will be clearly written that whatever the number is given, it is the perfect cube. So find the cube root of the number without prime factorization. So in the question it will be clearly written, find the cube root of this number by the without prime factorization if it is the perfect cube number. So that method you can apply. So got it clear? Okay, so now Bhumi Verma kindly Bhumi, yes, page number 55. Okay, just wait, page number 55. Yes, question number. Question number 1, F part. Okay, all rhombus are kite. Okay. So here I'm going to. Okay, so I'm going to explain that F part. No, that is not given to all rhombuses are. Achha, that is given true. Okay. I'm going to explain that. Question number 1. Two statements will be there. If it is given that every kite is a rhombus, that will be false. So again you need to check that whatever the question is given. If suppose that it is given all the kites are rhombus, that will be false. But if it is given all the rhombus are, so that is given false. So here I'm going to so here I'm going to explain that, okay, so that it will be easier to understand you. Now it is the question number 1 and it is the F part. Only in this question it is given on page number 55 and question is given all rhombuses are kite. Here it is given that all rhombuses are kite. So statements here it is given all rhombuses are kites and you need to decide that whether it is true or false. So first I am going to draw a rhombus. Any students who can explain that what is the rhombus? Any of the student? What is called the rhombus? Yes, students, all of you know the definition of the rhombus. Yes, any other? Astha, what is? Yes, Aditya, what is the? A rhombus, that is a quadrilateral whose all the four sides are equal. So here I am going to draw a rhombus. Suppose that here I am going to draw a rhombus. Suppose that here it is A, B, C, D. So A, B, C, D is a rhombus in which all the four sides are equal. Now students, one question I am going to ask. Suppose that if any quadrilateral is given, if I am going to ask that what is called the adjacent sides. If I am going to ask that, what is the adjacent sides in the quadrilateral ABCD? What is the adjacent sides? You had used that word, adjacent sides and opposite sides. Two lines segment. That is the, if two line segment having the same vertex. Yeah, you can say that if two sides having the common vertex. So here AD and AB. Both having common vertex A, both are going to start from A. So here AD and AB are called the adjacent sides. In the same way, BC and BA, that are also the adjacent sides. BA and BC, both having the B point common, BA and BC. In the same way, CB and CD, both having C point common. So it means that these are the pair of adjacent sides. And what is called the opposite sides? Opposite sides. not the parallel side, you can say that two sides which doesn't having a common vertex. For example, if I'm going to say that AB and DC, in AB you are going to get the vertex A and B, and in the DC you are going to vertex D and C. So both are not having any common vertex. So both are called the opposite sides. So again, I'm going to repeat, if two sides having a common vertex, that is called the adjacent sides, and if two sides doesn't having any common vertex, that is called opposite side. Now, if I'm going to ask about a kite, what is called the kite? What is the definition of the kite? Okay, no, that is not the unequal opposite side. That is definition. Only the definition is that a quadrilateral in which adjacent sides are equal, that is called the kite. So here if I am going to draw like this, suppose that if I am going to draw like this, here it is, suppose that A, B, C, D. If AB equal to AD, AB and AD are the adjacent sides and BC and DC are the adjacent sides. So here these two adjacent sides are equal and these two adjacent sides are equal. So it means that AB, CD is a kite. Got it? So it means that if in a quadrilateral adjacent sides are equal, that is a kite. So here I had drawn a rhombus. Now I am going to check that it is going to follow the property of the kite or not. I am going to take AD and AB. AD and AB are equal. Students, AD and AB are equal. It means here AD and AB are the adjacent sides and both are equal. That is the one pair of adjacent sides. Now I am going to check for the second. Here DC and BC are also equal. These are the second pair of adjacent sides. So in the rhombus also here I am going to get both pair of adjacent sides are equal. It means it is going to follow the property of the kite. So that's why each and every rhombus will be a kite. So got it clear? Okay, but suppose that if the same question is given for the parallelogram, all the parallelogram are kites, so that will be true or false? That will be false. Suppose that if I'm going to draw a parallelogram ABCD, and if I'm going to ask that is this parallelogram is a kite, so you will check that here adjacent sides are equal, so AD and AB are equal. It is the parallelogram. So in the parallelogram, opposite sides are equal. These two sides will not be equal. So these two are the adjacent sides and both are not equal. So that's why it is not a kite. So if the same question is asked for the, if all the parallelogram are kites, so that will be false. But if it is asked that if all the rhombus are kites, that is true. If in the same way, if I am going to ask that all the squares are kites, all the squares are kites, that is true or false? That is true. That will be true. Okay. In the square also all the four sides are equal. So here this side equal to this and this side equal to this. So here adjacent sides are equal. It means all rhombus as well as all the squares are kites. So that is the this part. So again, if anyone having the doubt regarding this. Yes, Bhumi Verma, your doubt is clear. Yes, Bhumi. Okay. Nine. So that will be true. Reason is that if you are, you need to only relate the definition. That definition is going to be followed or not. Okay. 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 Now next, Priyanshu Verma. Yes. Question number. Okay. So I'm going to open the exercise 1.1 and question number 3. Okay. Okay, so in the exercise 1.1, question number 3 is given. It is question number 3 of exercise 1.1. And question is given, verify minus x, it is equal to x. And for which part you need the explanation? Two parts. First, okay. In the first, it is given that x equal to 11 by 15. X is 11 by 15. Okay, for this number you need to find that it is true when minus minus x equal to x. So students, if you are going to solve, if this number is given x equal to 11 by 15, if I am going to ask that what is the additive inverse of this x, if I am going to ask that additive inverse of x, that will be minus x of x will be minus x. So here x value is 11 by 15. So additive inverse of 11 by 15, that will be minus 11 by 15. Okay. So if I am going to ask that additive inverse of x will be minus x, so additive inverse of 11 by 15 will be minus 11 by 15. Now if I am going to ask that what is the additive inverse of minus x? Additive inverse of minus x, you will write additive inverse. You are going to put the negative sign before the number, that will be the additive inverse. So if I am going to write the additive inverse of minus x, that is equal to minus minus x. If the number is minus x, so that number you will write it here, and here it is going to show that it is the additive inverse. So if the number was positive, so you have written minus and here it is x. But if the number is negative, minus x, then you will write additive inverse of minus x is minus minus x. Any doubt up to here? Okay, if the number is negative, so you have written that number, and for the additive inverse you are going to put the minus sign. The same steps you had followed it here also. If the number is positive, so you had written here plus x, and additive inverse is there, so minus and that number. So again, if the number is minus x, so I had written that number minus x, and for the additive inverse I had put here minus sign. Now students, minus minus x, if just after minus you are going to get another minus, it is equal to minus and minus together, that will be plus x. It is written as x. So if minus minus x equal to plus, so here if I am going to write minus and x value it is 15, so minus minus 15, that is equal to x, and what is the value of x? That will be 11 by 15. X value is 11 by 15. So minus minus 11 by 15 equal to, that will be 11 by 15. So only you need to write this statement. All of you know that if negative of the negative you are going to do, that will be positive. That is the basic thing. But here a little bit statement you need to give. Bas ye aapko statement thoda sa likhna hai. Otherwise, all of you know that minus minus, that will be plus, so it will be plus x. So that is the basic calculation. But here these much of steps are there, so that you need to write. So got it clear, Priyanshu? Okay, so some steps are there that you need to follow. If you are going to write the steps 2 or 3 times, that will be learned to you also. Otherwise, it is the basic thing. Reason is that if the question is going to be asked, that will be the having the option also. 4 options will be given. If I am going to ask that what is the value of minus minus 15, then it is not, you are not supposed to give the steps. The options will be given like this. It will be given like that, minus 11 by 15. B will be given plus 11 by 15. C will be given, suppose that 15 by 11. Yeah, D it will be minus 15 by 11. So only there you will be given the option. So there you are not supposed to give the steps. So what will be the correct option for this? That will be 11 by 15. So if you are going for the online examination, so there will be the objective type question. So you are not supposed to give the steps, only you need to write the correct answer. Okay, so yes, Saket Tejas. Saket. Saket, you were having the doubt. Okay, exercise 8.2, question number 7. So I'm going for the question. exercise 8.2 question number 7. Okay. So kindly open the exercise 8.2. It is the exercise 8.2 and here it is the question number 7. Okay, the question is given, a milkman sold two of his buffalo for rupees 20,000 each. So here it is given that a person is there who is going to sell his two buffalo. And what is the selling price of both the buffalo? That is given 20,000 each. It means here you will write selling price of both buffalo. Selling price of both buffalo, that is equal to rupees, it is given 20,000. So that person was having two buffalo and he had sold both the buffalo at 20,000 rupees each. It means selling price of both the buffalo was 20,000 and 20,000. Now it is given that on one he had gain of 5%. It means on first buffalo gain percent, that is given, gain or profit percent equal to, that is 5%. And on the second he got the loss. So second buffalo loss equal to, that is given 10%. So that person is going to sell two buffalo at 20,000 rupees each, but on the first buffalo he got a gain of 5% and on the second he got a loss of 10%. Now what you need to find? You need to find his overall gain or loss. It means that if you are going to calculate the overall, like in both the buffalo, he is going to get profit or loss. So how you will calculate? First you will calculate the cost price of both buffalo. Selling price of both buffalo is given, and after that you will be able to compare he is going to get profit or loss. So here, if I am going to ask that CP of first buffalo, okay, yes, kindly unmute it. I am going to get the disturbance. Okay, Saket, you need to unmute. Saket, kindly unmute and give me the answer. What is the CP if selling price and gain percentage given? Give me the formula for the CP, Saket. Okay, Prachi, yes. Give me the formula. CP equal to 100 into SP upon, yes, 100 plus profit percent. So I had given the, that is the formula for the CP if profit is there and selling price is given. So here what is the, if you are going to find the CP of the first buffalo, to 100 into selling price of both the buffalo was 20,000 each. So selling price of the first buffalo is 20,000 divided by 100 plus profit percent. So 100 plus profit percent is 5. So 100 plus 5. So it is equal to 100 into 20,000 upon 105. So you need to calculate it. After calculation, here you will get the CP. That you will get after calculation. So got it, Saket? After calculation, you will get the CP of the first buffalo. In the same way, you need to find the CP of the second buffalo. So in the second buffalo, he is going to get the loss. So what will be the formula for the, this one? If he is going to get 100 into selling price upon 100 minus loss percent. That will be the formula if the loss is there. So for the loss, here you will write 100 minus loss percent, and for the profit, you will write 100 plus profit percent. So after this, you will calculate it. Here I am going to erase this. So you will put the value for the second buffalo. So CP of second buffalo, that is equal to 100 into selling price of the second buffalo was again 20,000. So it is 20,000 upon 100 and minus loss percent. And what is the loss percent for the second? 10. So 100 minus 10. So it is equal to 100 into 20,000 upon 100 minus 10, 90. So after calculation of this, you will get the CP of the second buffalo. So now, if I am going to ask that, what is the selling price of both buffalo? Any other event? Selling price of both buffalo equal to? That will be 40,000. That will be 40,000. Okay, so here selling price of one of the buffalo is 20,000. So selling price of both buffalo equal to selling price of both. That is equal to 20,000 plus 20,000. That is equal to rupees 40,000. And CP of both. So CP you will get after calculation. Whatever the calculation you are going to get here and whatever the calculation you are going to get for this. So you will add both. So here you will get after addition of both the CP, you will get the CP of both the buffalo here. Now, how you will decide that the person is going to get profit or loss? How you will calculate he is going to get overall profit or loss? How it will be decided? Okay, yes, very good. Okay, so you will decide after calculation of this, you will get both the numerical values. Selling price is 40,000, that is here, but CP you will get after calculation, and after that you will check that which is greater. Suppose that if selling price is greater than cost price, then he will get the profit. You will write it here, selling price is greater than cost price, that's why he is going to get the profit. And if CP is greater than SP, suppose that if cost price is greater than selling price, here you can say that if selling price is less than cost price, then he will get the loss. So you need to check this condition after calculation of this. So that will be decided that overall he is going to get profit or loss. So Saket, it is clear? Yes, Saket, kindly reply me. Okay, students. So